Good morning and welcome to my presentation about breaking historical ciphers with modern algorithms. Let me start my presentation with a letter that was written in the 17th century during the 30 Years' War by the Austrian Emperor Ferdinand III. And as you might see, this letter is at least partially encrypted. And this is what I'm going to talk about today, about encrypted letters or encrypted documents. This is one example. Here's another one. This is text that was found in an archive in the USA. It's the so-called Winthrop cryptogram. It was written about 1650. And again, the headline can be read more or less. It's about the dissolution of one element in another. So it's probably an alchemical text, but the rest of the text is encrypted. Or look at this. This is the so-called Voynich manuscript, a book from the 15th century. And in this case, the whole book, 230 pages, is encrypted. Well, there are many others of this kind. Here are a few. These are completely different documents from completely different times, but all of them are encrypted. And now the interesting question is, can these cryptograms be solved with modern means? And a cryptogram, you can read it here, a cryptogram is an encrypted text from the view of somebody who wants to break this encryption. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. Before I proceed, let me introduce myself. My name is Klaus Schmäh. I work for a German company named CryptoVision as a security consultant and marketing manager. I also write a blog about historical cryptograms and the solution of these cryptograms. It's got the address www.schmäh.org. And I also write books about cryptography and crypto history. Most of them are in German. One or two of them are available in English, but most of them only in German, to my regret. Maybe I can have translated a few of them in the near future. But now let's get back to all these old encrypted documents that are in existence today. And the question is, how can these old cryptograms be solved? Well, first of all, the relevant time that I'm going to cover today is roughly between 1400 and 1970. So it's basically the pre-computer era. Oh, sorry. So around 1970, computers came up, but I'm only going to talk about encryptions that were made without computer aid. And now, another question is, if we're looking at this pre-computer time, which encryption methods were actually used before computers came up? Of course, there are quite many. There are dozens or even hundreds. But as we will see, in practice, only a small part of them played a major role. For example, the so-called monoalphabetic substitution cipher, also known as MASC. Well, this sounds complicated, but basically, it's a MASC, what you see here. It's a substitution table. We have the alphabet, and every letter of the alphabet is replaced with some sign, some letter, or it can also be a number or whatever. Or the same, more or less, can be done without changing the alphabet. So we have a simple substitution table with the same alphabet in the clear text and in the cipher text. In the one case, we have an alphabet change. In the other one, we don't have an alphabet change. But from the view of a code breaker, this doesn't make much a difference, of course, because it's always possible to replace these strange signs with an ordinary alphabet. And for analysis with a computer, this makes sense. And so we don't really distinguish between alphabet change and non-alphabet change. Here we have another example of an encrypted document. It's a Freemason's document from the 18th century. It's a MASC, letter substitution with an alphabet change. This means everything you see here, all these signs are letters. And, well, it's a document created by the Freemasons. This one was created by the Freemasons too. It's from the 19th century. And you see here, there's no alphabet change. And the next question I want to ask is, how can we solve a mask, a monoalphabetical substitution cipher? Well, most of you probably know the answer. We can use a frequency analysis. Well, it's well known that in the English language, the E is the most frequent letter, followed by the T, and the A is also quite frequent, and the N and the O. And as this is known, it can be used by a code breaker. I will give an example later. This technique has been known in Europe at least since the 14th century. But, of course, as this method can be used to break masks, other methods of encryption came up. For example, nomenclators. Nomenclator is basically a substitution, a mask, which is extended by letters or by numbers that stand for complete words. So if you want to encrypt the sentence, "We'll come from London to Berlin," we need to encrypt the word "will" letter by letter, the word "come" also letter by letter, the word to also letter by letter, but for "from," for example, we can use this one. And for the word "London," we can also take a word from this list, though this is a nomenclator. This technique was quite popular until the 19th century, and it was invented in Europe in the 14th century. Here we have an example. This is clearly a nomenclator. It was made in the 17th century. Here you see the letters that are replaced with numbers, but we also have letter pairs and complete words that are replaced with numbers. And this technique was used, for example, in the 17th century. This is a letter that was encrypted with a nomenclator. You see all the numbers. And later in the 19th century, the nomenclators grew to larger and larger sizes. Finally, there were complete books or code books filled with nomenclators, and, well, basically a nomenclator that fills a whole book is named a code book, but the technique is exactly the same. In a code book, usually there's an encrypted sign or a sign for every word of a language, so you can encrypt a text word by word, and this was used until World War II. This is an example from World War I, the so-called Zimmermann telegram. As you see here, it consists of numbers only, and every number stands for a word. Well, the question was, which encryption methods were used in the pre-computer era? Of course, there were many, but the most important ones were masks, nomenclators, and code books. And if you nowadays look at historical encrypted documents, I think about 80 to 90% of what you see in the archives is encrypted in one of these ways. Of course, there's more. For example, there's the so-called Fleissner grill, or there's the Enigma encryption machine, and many more encryption methods that were in use, but the most important ones were the one I showed on the last slide. Okay, so this was basically my introduction. Now I'm going to show a few examples, a few case studies. Let's start with the Winthrop cryptogram, the one I already introduced. It was written around 1650. As I said, the headline can easily be read, but the rest can't. And if we look at this, this looks pretty much like a mask, a substitution cipher, with an alphabet change. So what are we going to do to solve this encryption? Well, we are starting with a frequency analysis, which basically means we need to count the letters. And as you see here, oh, I can also show it here, this letter that looks like an 8 is the most frequent one. And it's followed by this one, which looks more or less like an S, and this one, which looks similar as an F. And this is basically all a good codebreaker needs, because if you know the most frequent letter, it's usually the E. The second most is not really clear. It could be the T or it could be an N. You need to guess and you need to do a little trial and error, but a good codebreaker usually can use this information to guess a few letters and to guess words and so get a few more letters, and within half an hour or so a good codebreaker can break this cryptogram if it really is a mask. In this case it was the case, and so here we have the substitution table that was derived by a codebreaker, and as you see the 8 actually stands for the E. The second most one is in this case the I and the J. The two letters were not distinguished in this text. This is why why this sign is especially frequent. And this one is the T. And if you now want to know what's in this text, well, it's an alchemical text about dissolving salt in some other element. And well, honestly, most codebreakers don't really care about what is written in these texts they decrypt. It's important to break the encryption, and once the encryption is broken, the work is done. And so I don't want to go into much detail about what's written in this text here. Well, this was an example of a text of a cryptogram that was broken with frequency analysis. Let's look at another one. This guy here is named Sabine Baring Gold. Well, in Germany, where I come from, Sabine or Sabine is a female name, but this is actually a man, or it was a man, a priest, who was also active as an author. He wrote a couple of books, nothing really important, and one of his not really important books contains a chapter which isn't really important either. It's named Curiosities of Cipher. And in this text, or in this chapter, there's an encrypted line, and the solution is not given. So this is interesting for us, because this means we have an encrypted text from the 19th century, pretty short, and the solution is not given. So let's try to solve it. Well, it basically looks like a mask with alphabet change. And of course, we could now count the letters, make a frequency analysis, but I want to introduce another technique for solving such or for solving cryptograms of this kind. It's to do so, we first need a transcription. That means we replace every sign or every character in this clear text with a letter from the alphabet. This then we get this one here. Simply means that we took this one as the A, this as the B, this as the C, and so on. And of course, it's a little easier to work on this encrypted text with a computer algorithm. And now we are going to apply an algorithm or a method that is called hill climbing. If you're into computer science, you probably have heard of hill climbing. It's a very powerful kind of algorithm. It's used for many different applications, and it can also be used for code breaking. Well, the first step is we generate a random substitution table. Second step, we take the ciphertext and decrypt it with this random substitution table, and we get a result, which is of course not the real plain text, but we can rate the correctness of this result with a so-called fitness function. This will be explained on the next slide. For now, just let's assume that we get a result that rates the correctness, and then we change the substitution table slightly, so we change a few letters, not too much, and then we decrypt the ciphertext again, and then we rate the correctness of this result again with the same fitness function. And now the question is, has the correctness of the result we have got increased? If yes, we keep the key. If no, we restore the key that was used before. And then we go back and do the same again, change the substitution table slightly, decrypt again, rate the correctness again. Again, we decide if the result has improved. If yes, we keep the key. Otherwise, we restore the old one, and so on. Now, this looks basically like this. Let's assume we have just some random substitution table and the result for the correctness of the text is 58, whatever that means. Then we change the table a little bit. We get 56, okay, it's worse, so we try it again. 54, also worse, try it again. Now we get 60, so it's better. And then we stay with the 60. And then again, we try several changes of the substitution table until we get a better result. Now we have 62, again, it's better. And this is how hill climbing works. We also always get to the next step if we get a better result from the fitness function. And we repeat this until finally the value doesn't improve anymore in spite of many tries. So in this case, the 66 is the best value we can get. And now we hope that this is actually the correct substitution table that we have now derived. And now, of course, we need to know how the fitness function works. We need an algorithm that rates the correctness of a clear text candidate. Well, this is not as difficult as it sounds. For example, we can construct a fitness function that is based on the letter frequencies. In this case, we take all the letters from A to Z. We compute the frequency of each letter in the text, and we know the frequency in English language, and of course, the difference should be as small as possible. And this is what happens here. So if we have a text that really looks like English language, we get a zero in most cases, and then we have a pretty low value. And in this case, the lower the result of the fitness function, the better. Well, it's of course quite easy to make it the other way around, and usually it is done the other way around, so we assume the higher the value, the better the result. And this is what a friend of mine, Bart Wenmakers, a very good codebreaker from New Zealand, what he did, he wrote a computer program which applies hill climbing on mask ciphers, and here you can see how this works. This is a substitution table Bart got, or the program used, and the result was 308. In the next step, it climbed to 341, then 343, and it got better and better. And as you see here, the clear text candidate gets better and better. The second last is a mird in the hand is worth two in the mush. Don't know if this really makes sense, but of course, finally, the correct solution is a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. And the interesting thing about this algorithm, hill climbing, is it doesn't require human intelligence. So you don't need to do any guessing. You don't need to look at the text and look if it makes sense. Everything is done automatically, and this is quite nice method to solve substitution ciphers. So basically, so in the end, this is the solution of Sabine Baring-Gould's cryptogram, a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. Not very interesting, but it shows how this works. Before I show more, let me say a few words about the current situation in the research of historical cryptanalysis. Well, those of you who are into cryptography certainly know that there's plenty of literature about code breaking, about linear cryptanalysis, about differential cryptanalysis, and all this kind of stuff. But at least 95% of the current literature is about modern cryptanalysis. So it's about breaking the AES or DES or whatsoever. And only a very small part is about historical cryptanalysis, what I'm talking about today. It only plays a minor role in modern code breaking. I hope this will change a little bit because it's very interesting to do historical code breaking. There are a few very important differences between modern cryptanalysis and historical cryptanalysis. For example, in modern cryptanalysis, the algorithm is always known. You know how AES works. So this is not the problem. In historical cryptanalysis, of course, you don't. If you see a cryptogram, you don't know which algorithm was used. The goal in modern cryptanalysis is to determine the key. In historical cryptanalysis, it's the clear text. In modern cryptanalysis, the ciphers are mathematically complex, like the AES. If you're lucky in historical cryptanalysis, it's not that complex. The clear text is known in modern cryptanalysis and can even be chosen. Of course, in this case, the clear text is usually unknown. In modern cryptanalysis, you have infinitely much ciphertext. This is not the case in historical cryptanalysis. Often you have only a very short amount of ciphertext. And finally, in modern cryptanalysis, reading the text is not really the problem. In historical cryptanalysis, it can be quite difficult to read a document that is 300 years old, and if the writing is not very clear, though this can be really a problem. But basically, it's justified to say modern cryptanalysis and historical cryptanalysis are two very different things. But there's a lot of research, or there's some research going on in historical cryptanalysis, and I hope there will be more in the near future. Another thing, at the moment there's not really an online forum or something like that for unsolved historical cryptograms. Well, the best one at the moment is my blog. Of course, I'm very proud of this because I publish a lot of unsolved cryptograms from former centuries. I'm proud that this is at the moment probably the most important place in the web to look for this topic. But of course, there should be more. It would be very nice to have a well-made web forum with thousands of people taking part and delivering unsolved cryptograms and solving them. There are projects going on to make things like these, but at the moment nothing like this exists. So if you have an unsolved cryptogram like an encrypted postcard from your grandparents or things like that, just send a scan to me and I will publish it on my blogs. And my readers are extremely good in breaking encryptions like these. So infrastructure is missing in historical code breaking. That's very important to note. And in spite of this missing infrastructure, there are still many successes because there are some very good code breakers working on these ciphers, and some of them are quite successful. So let's look at another use case. Now it's getting a little more complex. This is, this here is a good friend of mine, Carl de Leeuwe, a Dutch guy living in Amsterdam, and he's the leading Dutch expert, or the leading expert on Dutch crypto history. And in an archive in Amsterdam, he found this letter from 1745. It's obviously encrypted, but it doesn't really look like a mask, and it doesn't look like a nomenclator. It pretty much looks like a Fleissner grill. I'm sure most of you have seen such an encryption before. It's still used as a toy nowadays, but it was actually used in practice. To encrypt text with a Fleissner grill, one proceeds as follows. Well, let's assume this here is the clear text, to be or not to be. I've added a couple of X's to make the length of the message 16 letters, because this is what we need here. And now we have this stencil, the so-called Fleissner grill, and now we write the first four letters into this stencil, and then we turn it by 90 degrees. Do the same again. Turn it again. Well, I'm pretty sure you have seen something like this before. And finally, and this is what we get. This here is the cipher text. And it's a so-called transposition cipher, because nothing is replaced or substituted, but the order of the letters is changed. So let's get back to the letter Carl de Leeuwe found in a Dutch archive. And now the question is, if we have, obviously, a Fleissner grill encryption like this, how can we solve it? Well, Carl found a pretty simple way to solve it, a really ingenious method. What he did is he looked at some of the letters and he found, for example, in this line, there are three letters that are a little too low. And in the next line, there are four letters that are a little lower than the rest of the line. This was obviously an error that the encryptor made when he worked with this stencil. He didn't watch to have all the letters exactly on one line. And if we look at these letters which don't really fit, we get the word Ein, which is German, and we get Gegar, which could be a German word. And well, I can't go into all the detail right now, but Karl found a few other letters like this, and then he could turn the grill by 180 degrees and look if he get at the same positions letters again that make sense. And with this quite simple method, within an hour or so, he could break the encryption and he could derive the grill. It looked like this, and as you see here, the grill is quite regular, which made things a little easier, of course. Again, the clear text is not too important for us. It's a military message from the 18th century about French soldiers who were stationed in Camberg, Germany. It's not really relevant, but now we want to ask the question, is there also a crypto-analytical or mathematical method for breaking a Fleissner grill? And before I can tell you that there is one and how this works, let us look how a Fleissner grill can be constructed. Basically, we need a matrix. In this case, it's a 3x3 matrix, and we need to fill this matrix with random numbers between 1 and 4. And when we have done this, we can construct this 6x6 matrix, and the ones are written in the upper left corner. Here the 2s, here the 3s, here the 4s. Each time the corner is turned by 90 degrees. And now we simply need to put holes at these positions, and this is how we can construct a Fleissner grill. And especially this means that a 3x3 matrix defines a 6x6 grill. This is, of course, important if we're talking about a computer algorithm. We need a representation of this matrix, and we need to need a method to construct it. This is how it is done. And honestly, until a year ago, there was absolutely nothing mentioned about a method to solve a Fleissner grill in the literature I know. So I decided to ask my blog readers. I wanted to know if anybody knows a good method to break a Fleissner grill encryption. So what I did is, I took a 20x20 Fleissner grill, I took some text I wrote myself, and encrypted it with this grill, and I published it on my blog as a challenge. And I asked my readers, can somebody break this Fleissner grill message? And if yes, tell me how you did it. So what do you think? Do you think somebody could break it? And if yes, how long it lasted until somebody found the solution? Any guesses? Well, basically it lasted 3 hours before. yes, this guy here, Armin Krauss, it's a German computer scientist, and he's one of the best code breakers I know, an extremely skilled solver of encryptions, and I think he needed about 3 hours to break this encryption. Well, what he did is he used, you guess it, hill climbing. So hill climbing has become more and more the super algorithm of historical code breaking. Of course, he used it a little different than what I showed you before. The random key here is, of course, not a substitution table, but it's a matrix. Of course, a little larger than this one, but you certainly know what I mean. And decrypting the text is, of course, simple for a computer program. Rating the correctness with a fitness function. Of course, this needs to be done a little different, because we can't use, it's pretty obvious that we can't use letter frequencies, because the letter frequencies don't change when we encrypt the text with a Fleissner grill. We need to use something else. And what works quite well is the frequency of bigrams, of letter pairs, because letter pairs also have a certain frequency in the English language. For example, EN is quite common, but QT almost never happens. And this is a fact that can be easily used for constructing a fitness function. So this can be used here. If the key is changed slightly, this simply means, for example, that we replace the 4 with a 3. That would be one example. Decrypting the ciphertext again, writing the correctness again, and checking if the correctness of the clear text candidate has increased. And with this hill climbing algorithm, Armin Krauss solved the Fleissner challenge. Here's the text. Here's the clear text. It's just some text about the moon landing I took from Wikipedia and changed it a little bit. This is not really important. The important thing is, even large Fleissner grills can be broken pretty easily today with hill climbing. Well, this is something, well, I found out, but of course it was not really me who did the work, but it was Armin Krauss and a few others of my readers. Let's now look at probably the most famous historical encryption system, the Enigma. You certainly know the Enigma is a German encryption machine from World War II. Here you see a few soldiers using it. About 30,000 copies of the Enigma were built, so it was a pretty common machine. And today, several thousand Enigma messages are still in existence, but usually the clear text is not known. So it's extremely interesting to look at these messages and trying to break them. And actually, there are quite a few people who really do this. So let's look at how the Enigma works. This is a little simplified. Of course, the real Enigma doesn't have letters from A to F, but to Z. And what we have is we have three rotors, and each one is wired and connected to a current source. And now look at the A. Let's assume I press the A button. Now the current circle is closed, and a current is flowing through the rotors, and this here is a lamp. So here the A is encrypted to a C. Well, those of you who know the Enigma know that this is simplified, because in the real Enigma, the current goes twice through the rotors because there's an initial part named the reflector. I'm sorry that I don't have an animation for this at the moment, but it's not that important for us. What is important for us is that these rotors move. So after the first letter, one of the rotors moves by one unit, and this happens 26 times. And when after 26 letters, the second rotor also moves by one unit. It's like a speedometer counter. Here on this picture, you see the rotors, which are hidden here behind this part. And here are the lamps. Here's the keyboard. And here's an additional part of the Enigma, the so-called blackboard, which was not shown on my animation, but it's shown on the next slide, because now the question is how large the key space of the Enigma actually is. This is, to determine this, we need to look at a few things that are used as key by the Enigma. Well, first of all, many Enigma models had more than three rotors, but three of them had to be chosen as a part of the key, and the order of the rotors also was a part of the key. So rotor choice and order was the first part of the key. Second part of the key, the initial position of the rotors, of course. This is like a combination lock. And the ring setting, this means the letters on a rotor could be turned without turning the wiring. This means that this is also a part of the key. And finally, we have here the so-called blackboard, which basically is an additional mask, letter substitution. And this is the fourth part of the key. And now we can compute the key space of the Enigma. If we have six rotors to choose from, we have 60 rotor choices and selections. We have 17,576 rotor positions, we have 676 ring positions, and we have pretty many blackboard combinations. And if we take all of this together, we get 10 to the 23 keys, which is about 2 to the 76. In reality, it's a little less because not all of these plugboard positions are actually usable in practice because of the mechanics of this part of the Enigma. But anyway, it's pretty much, and it's at least too much to do a brute force attack. So if you're looking back at one of these encrypted Enigma messages from World War II, it's certainly not possible to solve such a message with brute force. But already in World War II, as most of you know, the British broke the Enigma, and of course the Polish before them did too. And to do so, they used a special machine named the Turing Bombi, this Enigma-breaking machine. It needed a part of the clear text, a so-called CRIP, to work. So it could not work on completely unknown text, but part of the clear text needed to be known. And there's a special mathematical principle behind it, but that's not the topic today, because today we're talking about solving historical encryption with modern means. And meanwhile, a better method has been invented by James Gillockley in 1995. Meanwhile, this method has been improved by a couple of guys, Frode Weyerud, Geoff Sullivan, Olaf Ostwald, George Lasry, and Michael Hörenberg is not mentioned here. So a lot of people have improved this method, and these are people who do Enigma cryptanalysis with modern means. And, well, guess which method they use? It's, again, hill climbing, of course. So the trick here is we have to separate the key into two parts. The first part is what you see here, the rotor choices, positions, and ring positions. And now the concept is to start a hill climbing, or we can also use a brute force attack on this first part of the key. But for this to work, we need a fitness function that works independently from the plugboard. And this is possible because the plugboard is only a mask, a lattice substitution, so there's still enough statistical information in the clear text, in the text we get. So without having the last step of decryption, we can use a fitness function, which is based on letter frequencies, to rate the correctness of the candidate we are getting here. And this is basically the trick. So we can derive the first part of the key separately. And once we have this, we can solve the mask, which can be done with frequency analysis or with another hill climbing attack. So this is the method that was invented by James Gillockley, and that was improved. So basically, the fitness function has been more and more improved in recent years. And this method based on hill climbing is a lot more powerful than the Bombi in the Second World War. And it doesn't need a CRIP, and it works even on really short Enigma messages. I think the shortest Enigma message that has ever been broken with this method is only 30 letters long. So the method works quite well. Okay, so let's now look at the last use case. This is a pretty short one because the solution is unknown, but anyway, it's the world famous Voynich manuscript. Well, the Voynich manuscript is a book written in the 15th century. Not much is known about it. It's not known who wrote it. It's not known where it was made. The content is not known. And most of all, it's not known what the text in the Voynich manuscript means. It's an unknown alphabet, so it could be something like a mask with an alphabet change. But it could also be complete nonsense. We simply don't know it. And if you want to know how the Voynich manuscript looks like, well, here it is. Well, it's not the original, but I think it's a quite good facsimile. You can look at it after the presentation. What is important here, some of the pages can be unfolded. This is what you see here. They're quite interesting, but it's completely unknown what these pictures mean. So the pictures you see here could be anything, and it's not better for the rest of the picture. So almost everything in the Voynich manuscript is a mystery, the text is a mystery, the pictures are a mystery. So there's not much. So far, codebreakers have not been successful in breaking it. Of course, there are pretty many statistical examinations of the Voynich manuscript text. For example, here's frequency analysis of the letters, and this looks pretty much like in an ordinary language like English or German. So the letter frequencies have been examined, but so far no language has been really matched with this. There are many other examinations as well. And basically, one can say fact number one, the text in the Voynich manuscript looks like a mask. And fact number two, it doesn't look like a mask. And there's a certain contradiction between these two findings. So very difficult cryptanalysis. And basically, what I wanted to say today, it remains unsolved. So if you're looking for a mystery to solve, and if you're a good codebreaker, why don't you try it? But hundreds of people have tried it before, and at least 50 of them have published solutions, so it's quite annoying. So every twice a year or so, somebody comes with a new solution, but so far, none of these solutions have ever been accepted in the Voynich community. So it's still unsolved. Okay, so let me summarize what I've told you today. First of all, breaking historical ciphers is a very active field of research, not as active as breaking current ciphers, but I hope this will improve in the coming years. There are many successes in historical code breaking. Many interesting cryptograms have been broken. But there's still some infrastructure missing. For example, there's no web forum for breaking historical ciphers. There's not even a software. So a real good professional code-breaking software simply doesn't exist. Many of the code-breakers I know have written code themselves. Maybe one day this can be put together to a really good professional code-breaking software, but we are still pretty far from having something like this. The hottest technique in historical code-breaking at the moment is hill climbing. So each time you have a historical cryptogram and you know what algorithm might have been used, hill climbing is a very good candidate in breaking this encryption. And finally, there are still many unsolved cryptograms around. For example, the Voynich manuscript, or this letter here from the 17th century is unsolved too. This is a more recent unsolved text, and this is also unsolved from the Second World War, and this is also unsolved. So if you're looking for a website where all these unsolved cryptograms are listed, look at this one, it's on my blog. I have a list of the 50 most important unsolved cryptograms, and there's a lot more. So the final message of my talk today is, there is still a lot to do. Thank you. Okay, we have still about 15 minutes for questions. Are there any? Yes, please.
How do different
languages vary with their frequency analysis? I was particularly wondering what would happen if you can't be sure what language. Yes, this is a problem that happens quite frequently because, of course, the letter frequencies for all the common languages are known, but they are different. In German, for example, the E is the most common letter too, but it's more frequent than in English. And the second one in German is the N, which is more frequent than the N in English. So if you don't know the language, you have to guess. This is quite common. You have to try three or four languages until you find the one that really fits. Yes? It was found by a guy named Voynich. This is why it's called that way. And he purchased it from a monastery, or it was actually a convent near Rome in 1912. So he was a book dealer, and he purchased a couple of books from this convent, and among them was the Voynich manuscript. This is how it was discovered around 100 years ago, and for about 100 years now, people have tried to solve it to no avail.
Hi. What has been unsatisfactory about the solution so far for the Voynich manuscript?
Well, basically, a solution needs to be reproducible, or if some part of the Voynich manuscript is decrypted, or if somebody says, I can decrypt this part of the Voynich manuscript, it must be possible to use the same method at another place in the Voynich manuscript and get a result. And so far, this has never really worked. So usually it's the case that people take the letters and change the order, and they take some substitution, and the same letter can be substituted to several others, and some letters are omitted and some letters are added. And if you use a method like this, you can decrypt anything. But if you try to use the same method at another passage of the Voynich manuscript, you don't get anything. This is how it works usually. Yes? Well, of course, it's possible that different parts of the Voynich manuscript were encrypted in a different way. If you look at the statistics, there are, as far as I know, two different parts that can be distinguished. So it's easily possible that there are two different encryptions were used. But still, if you solve one part of the Voynich manuscript, it should be possible to use the same method somewhere else. If it's only one part. And of course, it's in most cases it's very generic. So there are a lot of different assumptions made, and this might fit for one sentence, but that's not enough. You need to apply it somewhere else, and if it works, then it can be regarded correct. There was another question. Yes, please. That's a very interesting question. Well, basically, some people say, or you can read in the literature, that two hands can be distinguished. So two different ways of writing, at least. Others say you can, within these two hands, you can distinguish between more. But basically, there are two different writing styles. I'm not a handwriting expert. I have heard handwriting experts that it can still be the same person. Maybe this person used a different writing, different pen or different feather or whatsoever. Others say it must have been written by two different persons. I'm not sure about that, and as far as I know, there's no consensus about these questions in the research community. Well, my personal opinion is that it's a lot more likely that it was written by one person. Yes, please? Pardon? No, you're absolutely not sure that it's Latin. Almost everything has been proposed, Latin, German, English, but even Chinese and Mexican, and sometimes it's even ridiculous. Some people say it was written by extraterrestrials. It's almost nothing you don't find about the Voynich manuscript, and it's absolutely not sure that it is Latin. Yes, please? You mean the best success? Yes. Oh, let me think. What was the best success? There are a few very interesting Enigma messages that have been broken. For example, one about a resistance fighter in Germany who was killed in a concentration camp. And with an Enigma message that could be decrypted, it could be determined the day when he died. This is something how code breaking really added historical research. There are other examples. Let me think. For example, if you have heard about the man in the iron mask, that's a story from France in the 17th century. In the 19th century, a codebreaker from France said he had encrypted a few old cryptograms from the time of the man in the iron mask, and he could prove who he really was. It turned out that it was probably not correct, but if it had been correct, it would have been a very helpful piece of... But for about 100 years or so, it was believed that he was correct, but newer research shows that this was probably not the case. There's certainly more. Well, maybe after the talk, I can think of a few, yes. Any other question? Yes? Arabic or Hebrew? You mean the Voynich manuscript that it... this one here, the one... these are theories that have been researched. I'm quite sure about that. Arabic, some say it might have been Arabic copied by somebody who didn't know Arabic, so he wrote from left to right. Letters that are usually written from right to left, and this is the reason why it looks so strange. It's one of many theories, but it has never been proved. The same with Hebrew. I'm sure that somebody has done some research about this, but so far it hasn't led to a solution of the Voynich manuscript. Yes? Yes, it's well possible that the whole content of the Voynich manuscript is nonsense. So the nonsense hypothesis has become more and more popular in recent years. And actually, I'm also quite a fan of this nonsense hypothesis, because if it was really an encrypted text, it would have been solved, because usually texts from the 15th century can be solved today, especially if you have a whole book of material for analysis. But I'm not sure. Or maybe it can be encrypted one day. And the question is how it was really created, because filling a whole book with garbage that still has statistical properties that are similar to a natural language isn't as easy as it sounds. But there have been propositions how this could have been made. For example, with a certain stencil technique. Gordon Rugg, a British scientist, has made a suggestion which goes like this, but so far nothing is proved. Yes? Yes. I don't know the exact answer, but it's well known that statistical analysis of language doesn't go back to the 15th century. So in the 15th century, when this book was written, it's absolutely impossible that the one who wrote this book knew a lot about statistics of language. So in theory, of course, it's possible to mimic statistics and to produce some text of which you know that it resembles natural language, but it's pretty sure that this didn't happen in the 15th century, at least not on purpose. Of course, this person might have come up with something that is similar to real language and had statistical properties that were similar, but probably not, certainly not on purpose. Yes, please. Not really. Well, if it was the case, what you say, so if it's just an ordinary text written in an unknown script, it would be, from the point of view of a code breaker, it would be a mask, a letter substitution. Of course, if the language is completely unknown, if the language is completely lost, it would be difficult. But there have been cases with old languages that have been decrypted more or less without knowing the language. That goes a lot far back, let's say in the Babylon, yes, and things like that, like 3,000 years ago. There are quite a lot of languages that are lost, but the writings still exist. And some of these writings could be decrypted without knowing the language. So linguists today are pretty good at things like that, but so far nobody has come up with a good solution of the Voynich manuscript. Yes, please. Sorry, could you use a microphone, please?
Would it make any difference to the statistical analysis based on the way that languages change over history and different dialects of those languages?
Yes, well, it's certainly correct that languages change and that the statistical properties of the languages change as well. But there have been examinations taking this into account. So, for example, comparing this with English of the 15th century or with Latin of the 15th century, so far this hasn't led to any success. But it's maybe one possible reason why it can't be explained. Maybe it's some language that was around in the 15th century which had completely different statistical properties. Could be a reason, but nothing is proved so far. Yes? How I got my interest? Well, it's basically I studied computer science at a German university, and my main field of interest was cryptology. So I'm more or less a trained cryptologist about modern cryptology. But in the lectures, I heard about the Enigma, and this was how I got interested in historical cryptanalysis. The Voynich manuscript came about 5 years later or so. It wasn't known to me for a couple of years, but then about 10 years ago, I wrote my first book about, or it's already 15 years ago, about historical cryptanalysis, and this is how I got involved. It's not really a childhood interest. I know many people who are involved in this topic who said, well, already as a child I was interested in codes and code breaking. This is not really the case with me. Any other questions? Yes? Yes, what's the name of this woman you mentioned?
John Dee.
He was, I think, an alchemist or things like that in the 17th century, and he has always been considered as one of the candidates who wrote the Voynich manuscript. But a couple of years ago, radiocarbon analysis was made, and it showed that it was much older. So it was written in the 15th century, and John Dee lived, I think, in the 17th century. So he can't be the author, but John Dee invented something like an artificial angel language or something like that. It's a hypothesis that has been examined. It's one potential explanation, but so far no artificial language whatsoever has been known that was invented already in the 15th century. Okay, I think we have to stop now, or any other very important question. Otherwise, I'm available in the break. And thanks, and have fun with the next presentation.